A few housekeeping things before we begin. There are restrooms right here. There are also restrooms down this hallway to the left. We have refreshments in the back for after. This program will not have an intermission. It will play straight through, and then there will be an opportunity for some open console afterwards if you want to take her for a spin. I'd like to thank our host, Paul Rowland of Carma Labs, for hosting us this afternoon. This is the world's largest theater room. Every time we have a program here, which is usually about twice a year, they always add something. So it's always like a new instrument every time we hear it. And we're very blessed to have two very talented organists perform today. Before we begin, Paul just has a few words.
Thanks, Ryan. I want to thank all of you for coming. How many people was it your first time here? Hold your hand up.
Whoa.
Oh, we got some newbies. Maybe I should take 30 seconds and explain what a theater organ is. It's behind the swell shades are about 6,500 pipes. And they imitate different instruments, from violins to trumpets to you name it, including we have kind of a full orchestra, a concert grand Steinway. And they were meant to imitate basically an orchestra. This one was built based on the Wanamaker organ in Philadelphia, so it's kind of a symphonic instrument. The biggest pipe is around the corner. It's about 32 feet tall, 16 hertz, and the smallest is the size of a number two pencil eraser, a little tiny pencil. An organ plays at one volume, which is loud. So you build it, the rooms up there are built very, very hard, it's a thick, dense walls, and the organ controls the volume by either adding sets of pipes or by, there's a pedal here that opens and closes louvers. So you'll see louvers opening and closing. We'll go on later, but I just want to thank you all for coming. I really appreciate you being here.
Thank you, Paul. For those of you who bought 50-50 raffle tickets, thank you very much. Again, the Dairyland Theater Organ Society is a nonprofit dedicated for the promotion and preservation of these wonderful instruments. And Mike Jackman from our club is going to speak just briefly about what those proceeds are going towards. But we do offer programs monthly, either they're concerts or their socials. There are crazy people that have these in their homes. We do potluck arrangements. I was talking to myself. But anyway, we have that as an offering. So if you're interested in a membership, please speak to Neil or anybody in a red polo, such as Lynn, holding up some membership forms. Here's my champion.
So as Ryan was telling you, our 50-50 raffle helps the instruments that we're working on right now. We have one project that we are dedicated to working on right now, and I believe we have a minimum of two, possibly three, sitting in the garage waiting to go. These are not small projects, they're very quite large projects involved. The one that we're working on right now, we've been doing a complete restoration on for about 3 years, three and a half years. That's now going into the Geneva Theater. So, how many of you bought your raffle tickets for today? All right, hands down. How many still need raffle tickets for today? And then I'll tell you what the pot is at. All right, the pot is just over $325, so that means somebody will be taking somewhere over 150, depending on how many tickets these last few folks buy. This is your last opportunity. Once we get into the first number of the program, we're not going to be selling any tickets anymore. Also, if you want more information about us, what we do, and joining, see Mark or Lynn. They have the membership forms and the information for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike. All right, now I have the honor to introduce our first musician. We have two for you this afternoon. Jelani will be playing first. He's originally from Muncie, Indiana, and he began playing piano at age 4. At age 8, he heard his first theater pipe organ at the Indianapolis Paramount Theater. At age 13, he won the American Theater Organ Society Young Theater Organist of the Year Award. He holds a doctorate from Yale in law, and as a day job, he practices law. And then he also tours the world giving magnificent concerts. So please join me in welcoming Jelani Eddington. This instrument is truly remarkable. It's unlike any in the world. This is the largest theater organ with just over about 6,500 pipes. And in the process of designing this, we didn't design the organ just to be large for the sake of being the world's largest. We wanted to have a very extensive musical palette of different sounds, different colors, different effects, and you can see a lot of them out here. A lot more are back behind the shutters, the black shutters that you can't see. But what we wanted to do over the course of this afternoon is put together a musical experience of a variety of sights and sounds and colors and styles for you to enjoy. That first piece of music, something that was written by Jules Stein from the 1959 musical Gypsy, something called Some People.
What I'd like to share with you next is a little bit of music by one of my very favorite composers, Leroy Anderson. This is a piece that he wrote to be in the style of a Viennese waltz, if you can imagine, in Vienna, the balls with the flowing costumes and the gentleman in top hat and tails and all of those wonderful sorts of imagery in this next piece of music. I hope you enjoy it from Leroy Anderson. Here is The Bell of the Ball. Thank you very, very much. I know there are a lot of you who are here for the first time this afternoon. For those of you who have been with us before, you may not be used to seeing all of the other instruments that are sitting up here. There is a beautiful Steinway D concert grand piano, and those of you who are sitting here in the front, you may actually be able to see from time to time the keys will actually play. You can play that piano from the organ console, so another sound that we can control from here. And also a drum set. We'll tell you a little bit more about that in just a few moments. But I wanted to share with you a piece of music that will feature the piano and the organ as a duet. And this is a piece of music that, a beautiful, beautiful ballad that was written by a very, very talented composer, Stephen Sondheim. And the name of the piece is called Anyone Can Whistle. It'll give us an opportunity to explore a lot of the softer sounds of the organ, the more delicate sounds of the organ, and then you'll also hear the piano as well. But to help me do that, I'd like to introduce to the stage my good friend and colleague who is going to sort of be my partner in crime this afternoon as we explore the different sounds of these various instruments. The gentleman you're about to hear, it's been a pleasure for me to know him for now just about 20 years. When I met him for the very first time, in fact, it was in Milwaukee in 2004, he was only about this big, so a lot has changed over the years. And in that time, I have had an opportunity to get to know him very well as a friend, as a colleague, and he just this past year was named by the American Theater Organ Society as the Organist of the Year. So it's a great privilege to be able to welcome to the stage my good friend and colleague, Donald Rankin.
Oh boy, here we go. Some of you have met me before and know I normally don't sound like this. Obviously, with the temperature changes, my body hasn't agreed with it. So I'm going to do as little talking as possible. And unfortunately, I have to introduce a medley which involves the most talking. So, anyways, what I'd like to present for you next is a medley of music from TV and movies. And there's a certain franchise that's been around for almost 60 years now. And that, of course, is Star Trek. And so in this, you're going to hear the theme from Star Trek The Next Generation, a piece called Ilia's Theme from the 1979 Star Trek motion picture, something called Enterprising Young Men from the 2009 Star Trek film, and then I'll wrap it up with the theme from the original series from 1966. Oof, made it. Anyways, here's the music.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is my privilege to welcome back my very good friend, Jelani Eddington.
Thank you very much. That was a little piece of incidental music written by the great George Gershwin. He actually wrote that for Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers for the movie Shall We Dance, the musical movie Shall We Dance. It's a piece called Walking the Dog. And you can kind of hear that rhythm of walking the dog sort of throughout the piece. As I mentioned at the very beginning of the program, one of the things that's so much fun for both of us with this instrument is how versatile it is and how many different styles of music, everything from Leroy Anderson to George Gershwin to the music of Star Trek. And we wanted to show it off also in another vein. This is a piece of music that comes from about 1979, and a somewhat unusual source. If you've been to organ programs before, you may not have heard this particular piece done before, but it works really well here. I have always really loved the Swedish-born group ABBA. And they did so many wonderful pieces over the years, things that were de rigueur in the disco era, and if you went into nightclubs or discotheques or any of those sorts of things, you often heard that music. This is a piece of music usually around about 12:30 or 1 in the morning you hear, and what's interesting about it is, and you've seen, and you've heard some of them already, but you'll see what we call the toy counter. So all of the different drums and cymbals and tambourines and all the sort of special effects of the organ. One of the things we can do is pre-record some of that, so you have a little bit of a rhythm track behind you when you perform. And that's going to be the case with this next piece of music, something if you have, and you don't have to identify that you've been in nightclubs after midnight, it's fine. But it's a fun piece of music that I hope you enjoy. From ABBA, here is Gimme, Gimme, Gimme. Started way back in about 2007, and it's, as you could probably imagine by seeing everything that's here and hearing everything that the organ can do, it's sort of taken on a life of its own. But part of the fun in being involved in this project has been having the opportunity to work with the people who helped make all of this a reality. Of course, you heard from Paul Welding at the very beginning of the program, but of course, Terry Clevin and Bob Swaney, Century Pipe Organs, who were instrumental in helping to install the instrument. Ron Mitchell, also being very important in the tonal construction, the tonal design of the organ. I also wanted to take just a moment, because it just today happens to be the birthday of one of our beloved members of our technical team here, Mike Ryder, who I understand is celebrating a 29th birthday and holding. So somewhere around here, I'm not sure where Mike is, if he's back in the back, maybe you're hiding. Oh, right back there in the back. Stand up and wave. There he is. There's Mike. He's made many, many trips down here over many, many years to help get everything put together, and very much responsible, a big part of the sound that you're hearing this afternoon. So let's join in singing the Happy Birthday song.
Whoa.
Whoa. Yahoo. It's on wheels.
But it is on wheels. Normally it lives sort of over in that corner, so we can move it around. And if the organist gets a little bit too excited up here sometimes, it ends up in a different part of the room. So that's part of the excitement. So please welcome back to the stage Donnie Rankin.
You still have to play. Yeah. We're not done. The next piece of music that we'd like to share with you, it's a little hot there. See how much we can move around. Next piece that we're going to share with you is a little something that's going to feature organ and drum set. And this is actually a piece of music written by someone whose name you might recognize, but you probably recognize his most famous piece, which goes a little something like, na 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 na, Batman. And that, of course, is Neil Hefti. This one heavily features the drums. It's a great jazz standard. Something called, it's appropriate for myself, cute.
Thank you.
Yes, you have my permission to leave now. The next piece I'd like to share with you is a ballad. And this one has always been a favorite. I do a lot of things. I have six jobs. I work in two different bars. I work part-time at Walgreens. I'm a full-time corporate trainer. I do organ concerts, and I teach piano and drums. So I sleep sometimes, too. Apparently not enough. But in teaching piano students, a lot of the times, you know, we'll work on a piece of music, and I'll say, why do you want to learn this piece of music? And they say, the lyrics. And I say, well, what is it about the lyrics? And they say, I just love the way that he says, baby, baby, baby. And if you're familiar with Justin Bieber, he says it about 63 more times. And so me being the cynical piano teacher that I am, say, well, if you want good lyrics, there's a piece of music that I like, and let me recite you some of the verse. And so the verse, there are actually two different verses. The one, normally I recite both, but not today. The one is, for ages and ages, the poets and sages of love, glorious love, always sing. But ask any lover, and you'll soon discover the heartache that romance can bring. And then they look at me and they're like, wow, this guy's depressed. Anyways, this, of course, written in 1931 by E.A. Swan. This is When Your Lover Is Gone.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. That will actually bring us up to the last piece that we want to formally present to you today. A couple of weeks ago, if we could have moved this forward, 2 weeks, this would have been really awesome, because 2 weeks ago, one of Gershwin's biggest works turned 100. And that just gave away what we're going to do next. If you don't know, well, it's going to take him coming out. I'll get you back out here in a second, you're fine. This next piece runs about 16 minutes. It was originally written by Gershwin. I believe it was orchestrated by Paul Whiteman. And it made its debut, like I said, 100 years ago. I, nearly 100 years ago, started learning this on the piano. But I get the easy job today. So would you please welcome back for the hard job, Jelani Eddington. It's been a thrill getting to study with Jelani for, we studied from 2007 to 2012, and now we get to do stuff like this together, but it's great getting to work with you, and fingers crossed we can do this. Here is Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue.
Thank you. Thank you.